invite DMB Dr. Sunita Shinde to please be the chairperson and Gaikwad sir as a rapporteur for the second session. Once again, I would like to welcome all our respected guests, Honorable DG sir and respected principal sir. Now, I would also request our chairperson to please introduce our first speaker for session A, Shri Pradyumna Mishra Das. So please, I would please come on stage.
Good afternoon to all. Pradyumna Mishra Das. He has done engineering in computer science in 2000, followed by M.Tech in computer from BGTI Institute. He played the role of team leader for developing software products and services. During his student life, he came in contact with wisdom of Gita. Thereafter, he applied the teaching of Gita in his student as well as professional life. He plays variety of roles of organizing the event and spiritual retreat to inculcate education and training program. He also part of training and education department of ISKCON Chowkari. Sir, please start.
My pleasure and honor to be with all of you. So before starting, offer my respect professors to my spiritual master and my all previous teachers. Om Kyanam Vigaran Dasa, Kyanam Janashalaya, Chakshuru Vedakya, Tasmai Shri Padme. It's really an honor to be here. I must thank Narayan Harikar sir. It's my second fortune to be here, second fortune to be associated. The first, because I am in the same institute as sir has served for the last 5 years. And the second time being here, again associated with the MGM and this conference. Very thankful to all of you. So today I will be talking about integrating ethics with the integrating ethics and values in a technical education. Technical education, if you look into, education always needs, it cannot be just done by the books. It needs somebody, what we call it as a coach, right? A coach who can guide through us, who can lead us through the education. So, what the formula I have for the coach is, coach, CO stand for competence, A stand for attitude, and CS stand for character. Competence, attitude, and character, which are very necessary, necessary ingredients to form as a coach. This is a coach formula what I have. Now what that coach is, let's see ahead. Competence, attitude, and character. What the competence is, expertise, skills, and experience. Now, most of our technical education, what we give is more on the competence side. We give expertise, we give skills, and based upon that experience, he is developed. He is developed his competence to work. to do more innovations, right? So, and of course, attitude and character. So I'll tell you one of my story of one of my colleagues. Way back in 2000, I used to share a bench with him. He was part of assignments with me, and one of the projects he was like my team member too. Let's call him MK. I'll not name the fool. MK. So this Mr. MK, he was very good caliber. He was actually class topper throughout in all our engineering days. He was a class topper throughout. To the few subjects he even taught in the universities. So he had such an expertise and he had such a skill, right? But he was looking forward for some job, but none of the small jobs could satisfy him, and he was looking for something bigger. So went out, and the way didn't work out for quite long. But he kept on saying to the families and to the friends that, okay, I have a job, and I'm earning this much, I'm happy with it. But though he didn't have that job. So the family started demanding a few months later that, okay, send us some money. So at that time he was facing a lot of, going through a lot of turmoil in his life. What should I do now? Right? And then one fine day, I heard from a friend that his body was found on the tracks, railway tracks. Yes, he committed suicide. Imagine, he was a class topper, university topper, but he still could not survive his life. Why? So that makes him think about competition isn't all in all. Is that a competition isn't all in all? Right? What is the attitude towards life we should have? So this externals sometimes so much overpowers that I want to be having a good name and fame, I want to have a good reach, I want to become more and more rich, I want to fulfill those dreams. But this external so much overpowers that he has to sacrifice, he actually committed suicide. So what we need is more attitude towards a positive attitude towards life. Another, like, I used to, there are many students who comes to me and with their problems and we try to resolve them, counsel them. So one of my students, he came to me and he was saying that that he got a summer internship program. He was just in third year, probably second year passed up. He was just went to third year, but he got a summer internship with a top notch 5 firm. That consulting firm was in a top notch 5, and they are going to pay him 30K for a and he's supposed to be there for the summer training for 2 months. 30K per month. He was very jubilant because there was no one in his class who could have that much. So of course he had good technical background, he had a good competence, and that's why he could get that. He was jubilant throughout the semester that I got this and no one in my class got this much till the first day of his induction program when he met another intern from IIT Roorkee having the same profile as his but having a stipend 65K per month. His face became so morose, so small. What happened? One semester he was so jubilant. But just when he starts comparing with something, his face became so morose. Few days later, he told that he was sitting with the same IIT Roorkee boy on the lunch table, and that that boy told him, there's another boy who's from the IIT Kharagpur, and he's getting a stipend 1 lakh. Now this boy, this IIT Roorkee boy, his face was small, and then this student. He's like, okay, all right, misery loves company. So, the point I'm saying is, competence is not all in all. What we need is a positive outlook towards life, attitude. Some may say, okay, if you need a positive attitude, then let's have some positive attitude seminar. Will that boost up our positive attitude? It may, Having an example, let's say parrot. He's taught to greet the pupil with a very sweet talks, right? As soon as somebody comes, says, "Welcome, sir. What can I do for you? Please have a seat. Please take a water. Please wait. Somebody will attend to you." He speaks so sweetly till somebody catches his name. As soon as somebody catches his name, will be a smooth talk? No. He will actually chip, eat, right? It will not be a smooth talk for him, right? Same way, you know, when we go through the difficulties, you know, actually what is inside will come out. So attitude is nothing but, it's just a mere reflection of what we have to go inside as a character, right? So attitude is like a worldview and mindset, or a response behavior. How do we respond? What's our mindset is, right? But the more important is the character, which talks about integrity, intent, and the values, right? Competence is like what you do, how you act. Attitude is how you see, or what your vision is. But more important is the core within, which most of the technocrats forget on this. What we are being. What are your core values is? So we will be having some discussion on this now. So somebody say, okay, positive attitude means just I need to boost up my positive attitude. No. It will not be just an external show, unless and until we understand. It's a reflection of our all these core characters. It is a clear reflection of that. So what we need to build upon more is character. See, the education institutes more focuses on the competence. Some may focus on some attitude level, how to have positive attitude and other mindset and other, you know, perspectives of life. But these all remains as externals unless and until we build upon the character. These are our core values. So modern education floods students with the information, but sadly, the information brings hardly any transformation in the students. It leads to the strengthening of character. Many of the students indulge in the self-destructive habits like smoking, alcoholism, and drug abuse. And even the best of them consider earning maximum money as the most important value. Information, information, and information. Right? But there is no transformation. That's the plight of the modern education systems nowadays. We are flooded with so much of information, but there is hardly any transformation happening. So, technical education may give us competence and skills, but what about the likes and values? With my dear friend M.K., he has had a lot of skills and values, skills, knowledge, good education, but what went wrong? They didn't have life-saving values, right? So technical expertise can give us a living, can make our living, how much can earn, right? But values can make our life, and the ethics, based upon those values when we live, it can make a proper society. Einstein said, "Science can tell how things are, not how they should be." Science can inform you many things, but it will not give you how it can be used. And that's a question we need to ask. And that's where the ethics comes in a picture. Let's say, imagine one technocrat, and grandfather is dying. His grandfather is quite old, but he has a lot of property. The inheritance is going to come to him, right? The science will tell him, right, that if he put his arsenic into the breakfast of his grandfather, very soon the property will be inherited by him. The science will tell that. But whether to add that arsenic to the breakfast or not, science will not tell that. That's where the ethics has to come in the picture. The ethic has to understand, by his ethics he has to understand whether I should add that arsenic or not. Science can merely give us, you know, some chemical reactions. The science can give you some gadgets. but the emotions, right, this ethics and values we need to build up. So Einstein said that we can talk about the ethical foundation of science, but we cannot talk about the scientific foundation of ethics. Science cannot give us knowledge about what is right and what is wrong. That's how ethics comes into picture. So when we talk about the ethics and values, values acts as a fuel. Values comes as a big fuel. So what values means, what is valuable for us? What people value for today? Can somebody tell me? Open question to all of you. What people value for today? What is valuable for them? Being a technological institute, being you being a teacher or a part of the technology. What do you understand as values? What do people value the more? Somebody? Status? Okay. Gadgets? Anybody? Okay. Most of them value money, name, fame, or some of them may be innovations, right? That becomes their value. That becomes their fuel. So for example, the fuel is something which drives them. For example, apples. Apples are a dream. They are their motto. Make something different. Make something different. So their fuel was an innovation, right? And that's why they moved ahead. So values comes in a two ways, extrinsic and intrinsic. Extrinsic values depends on a lot of external things like money, position, and promotions, right? But the intrinsic values are something innovation, freedom to think over, self-improvement, purpose, why I'm driving it, what's my inspiration to drive it. That is something the intrinsic values are, you know. The incessantly glorified goals of the modern consumer society is fame, wealth, luxuries, power, pleasure, and prestige. And that's what encourages them to go immoral way. So now the norm is beg, borrow, steal, or even kill, but enjoy. Because of our values are so much on extrinsic side. But when we focus on the intrinsic values, then we can have some ethical society. So research shows, to motivate a person, sometimes the extrinsic values may be needed. You may give him promotions, you may give him some more money, right? Sometimes it may give you good results, but at certain point it becomes stagnant. However you increase his salary, it doesn't become productive, right? That's what it means by the external show. But when the intrinsic values are focused into those technocrats and those scientists, they the best of the things can come out. You can motivate a person by his intrinsic values. So strengthening our intrinsic values is a purpose. Rather than focusing on what they do or how they do, what we need to focus is on why we do. Why this technology is there, or how can? So values, if the values acts as a fuel, then ethics is like a traffic rules, something. So in any development of any product or technological innovations, many times what comes into the, when it comes to the factors, so most of the first factor what they consider is the economical cost. What will be the economic cost of that? And that's how they judge a product or that innovation. But now, when the ethics and the values are coming into picture, we need to look at the social cost and environmental cost for that innovation. What is the social cost? For example, just a regular example, let's say somebody, a beer industry, is opening up, right? It may have what is the social cost for that? It may land up into the, family distinction, right? So that's costing a lot for society. Or environmental cost. There's one cold drink which was very famous, right? It landed up the factory where it was situated, it landed up, the groundwater levels were going so down, and it has become so much desert. So that is costing us a lot from the environmental cost. So ethics should suggest us what is the economic cost and social cost and environmental cost, and then we should think of how much that innovation is viable for us, viable for the society, viable for the environment. So we need to be sensitive towards others, sensitive towards the society, sensitive towards the environment. We may well reach the point, is not too distant future, where all old things will collapse like a house of cards, and that unimaginable horrors will be perpetrated. Nobel laureate physics, the Wolfgang Pauli, he says that if the ethics are not there, our society will surely collapse. We have controlled machines, but the uncontrolled man. These are slogans. So we need to focus upon this ethics, which acts as a traffic rules. Imagine, if there are no traffic rules, what will happen? If there are no traffic rules, what will happen? Will we reach our destination? No, we will not reach properly our destination. If at all we need to reach our destinations, what will happen? We will have to climb over each other, right? We will have to play lot more, you know, different ideas to how do I cross over this traffic. So when the traffic rules are there, then I can reach my destination very much properly. Same is the ethics. We need to play the ethics well so that I have my destinations, I have my some goals. As a technocrat, you may have some innovations, or you may have some career ahead, or you may have some technological innovations to make. But is that fitting into the rules? Right? Otherwise, the industry now is a rat race. Very well said, rat race, no traffic rules. Right? We need to look into this ethics of the traffic rules for our smooth journey to the goal. Ethics are like a traffic. So we need to be sensitive to the others. What the world needs today is, you know, earlier the technocrat and scientist used to imagine that I have done my innovations, I have done my plans, I have taken out this product, and that's all in all. I don't have to bother what the world tells about it. I just innovate and just throw it to the world. But now the need is arising that the technocrat and scientist should stay with something, ethics and values on the table, and decide and think over whether this innovation, this product, will it be serving in the larger interest of people, right, to our society? Is it harming or making some sense to the world? Right? So earlier the science was not immoral, not a moral, but they used to take a stance of amoral. We don't bother about morality. But now we need to look into the larger responsibility of how this product can be used. Right? So the need for the, what the world needs today is, as far as technological advancement is concerned, we can keep improving our gadgets for a long time to come, but we need to ask about the question, is that what the world needs today? Despite the best comforts, millions of people today are suffering from depression, stress, hypertension, addictions, and suicidal urges. The technological super advanced best is now turning to East for its answer. Modern Indians are sitting on a 12 and begging for a class. We have such a wonderful culture by which we can bring about a lot of values and ethics in the society. Right? But we are looking towards the West. What is our innovations are? Right? What we need to understand first is, yes, with the technology, how can the ethics and values can be stored well? We are living in an Indian culture. It is such a heritage of culture. We should not forget what our strengths are. That's the point. So this is a British historian. He says, it is already becoming clear that a chapter which had a Western beginning will have to have an Indian ending, if it is not to end in a self-destructive of the human race. At this supremely dangerous moment in history, the only way of salvation for mankind is a Indian way. Another Swiss professor, he says, perhaps the contribution of India to the nuclear power technology and space science will turn out to be irrelevant over a period of time. But the contribution towards a new ethical foundation could be turning the wheel of history in a proper and a balanced way. Another British historian, he says, sorry. So I thank you very much for being attentive for this seminar. So my point was, the ethics and science and technology may can give us a lot of advancement in terms of gadgets, in terms of the competence. But what we need to build is a character to make a proper coach formula. I thank you very much for being an attentive. I'm also very much, I must thank to the Kedekar, Narayan Kedekar sir for me being here. So thanks a lot, sir.
Any questions from audience? So thank you, sir. You give the coach formula, competence, attitude and character. I agree that point, the modern education system no transformation, but the human value will make it definitely. Science can, and thanks for saying, science can tell how the things are, not how they should be, and give the example of her saying. We can also thankful for the given three traffic rule for ethics, economical cost, social cost, and environmental cost. Thank you once again.
Thank you so much, sir. Now I request the chairperson to please felicitate Shri Pratibha Das. I will invite our second speaker for the session, Shri Nandadalal Das, and request our chairperson to please introduce the speaker. And welcome to Nandadalal Das in MGM. He completed B.Tech Mechanical Engineering in 2000. During the final year, college came in touch with Bhagavad Gita, joined the International Society for Krishna ISKCON Chaupati Center in 2005. He is a part of team that organizes application-oriented lifestyle training program based on teaching and Vedic wisdom for college-going youth throughout the Maharashtra, part of editorial board Back to Godhead monthly magazine, and member of management council of ISKCON Chaupati Center. I welcome you, sir. Please start now.
Voice audio without this. Is my voice audio? Audio. my voice audible?
No, sir.
Am I audible now? All of you, it's a week day, and last 1.5 days at least, I myself attended a few sessions yesterday, and today I was only attended. And sometimes it kind of becomes a little repetitive. When so many speakers are speaking on the same topic, ethics, morals, values, and also it's not something that is our daily subject of discussion. So I can really commend all of you taking 2 full days out of our time and sitting here and trying to understand from different perspectives what is ethics, what is values. We are really grateful to all of you here. Now one thing I just want to clarify, here you can see I'm an engineer by qualification and I'm speaking on something in medical education. So just in case someone of you has a question regarding this, actually since 2007 we have been trying to distribute the knowledge of the Gita in medical colleges. So last 11 years we are interacting with many medical students, and that is where we have chosen this topic, that we spoke on technical education and we are going to speak on medical education. So are there any medicals sitting here in this hall? Because I heard it's an engineering college. Are there any medicals, doctors, somebody who has some interaction with doctors? Alright, so I know who I'm speaking to. I'll try to simplify my examples as much as possible. So just to go very swiftly, I was going to differentiate between ethics and values here. Ethics are moral principles that govern a person's behavior or the conducting of an activity, values, and we can easily understand it. But actually values is something that is personal. I may value truthfulness, I may value humility, I may value simplicity. But the social body around me may not value simplicity. I remember one Hindi movie in which the hero, when he would talk with his friends, on Saturdays he would say, I just need to go out for some time. And the friends would say, how come every Saturday morning he escapes from our group and goes out somewhere? So what did they catch hold of him and they asked him, where do you go to? Where do you go to that you cannot share it with us? Where are your thick friends? And then he reveals, actually main har shanivar Hanuman ji ke mandir mein jata hu. So why is he not able to tell his friends? Because it is not socially considered very good that a youngster in his college days is visiting a temple regularly. So that's what I mean, that values are something that is personal and this is something that is social. So I'll just show you some newspaper reports from prominent newspapers. So there is a Mumbai Mirror which recently came up with a report that in hospitals like Hiranandani Hospital, Fortis Hospital, these are big brands, these are trustworthy brands. But they pointed out that there is something called as a catheter, they insert inside the body, which was being reused. Not only was it being reused, it was also being recharged. So if it has already been used on one patient, it's been taken out, used on somebody else and again. So sometimes it was 4 or 5 times. I'll show you another report. This is regular, but this is Delhi's Betra Hospital kidney racket. Another one is private hospitals, this Times of India, private hospitals making profits up to 1,737%. So something costs 1,000 rupees, all of us sitting here, when we go to a hospital, especially a private hospital, we are paying 1,737 rupees for it. No wonder so many students want to join to become a doctor today. How many people gave the NEET exam this year? Anybody knows? NEET exam is the exam to qualify for medical doctors. Something like 11 lakh students in India gave this exam. And how many actually qualify? Less than 1.5 lakhs. So why is there such a big rush there? It is just because there's a lot of money there. So my question to you is there anything wrong in these 3 newspaper reports? Is there anything wrong in making money 1,737% times? Is there anything wrong in reusing some medical catheter that has already been used on one patient and reused on somebody else? Is there something wrong here? How many of you feel it is wrong to earn money? No, it's not wrong to earn money. All of us are sitting here trying to earn money, but who sets the limit? How much is right? How much is too much? Which percentage, if I put here, you will say, sir, this much money earning is good enough. But 1,737%, that is wrong. So that is what we are discussing here. We are discussing how there is a problem in the social ethics and the personal values. I know so many students in prominent medical colleges in Bombay, and one time I was speaking and he raised a question. He was trying to understand. I was explaining to him what is the need of the Bhagavad Gita. And we were saying, usually in life our problems are to choose between right and wrong. A typical teenager, his friends say, let's smoke. And something inside his heart, a voice from his mother, they tell him, don't smoke, this is not the age for smoking. Yes? So the conflict for a teenager is to choose between right and wrong. And I was telling him, what is the conflict of Arjun in the Bhagavad Gita? It is not a conflict between right and wrong, it is a conflict between two rights. The arguments that Arjun gives in the first chapter of the Gita, to not fight, none of those arguments are wrong. He gives social arguments. He gives scriptural arguments. He gives logical arguments. And what is Krishna's answer to it? Krishna says, whatever you are saying is right, but right now the situation demands that you rise to a higher level and see how in some situations even the rights that we have born and brought up with, even sometimes they can become wrong. So Arjun's problem is between two rights. So I was explaining this issue to some of the students, and we were talking about equality of vision also. In the fifth chapter, Krishna says, Vidya Vinaya Sampanne Brahmane Gavi Hastini Shune Chaiva Shva Pakecha Panditaha Samadarshina. So I'm saying how a knowledgeable person, a truly knowledgeable person, should not distinguish between people. And the example that Krishna gives in the Gita is, he sees an elephant, a dog, a cow, a dog eater, means somebody who is a very low person, and a pandit on an equal level. So there was some kind of a discussion that happened. They were saying, sir, how can we see everyone equally? It's just not possible. So I gave an example. And I'd like to ask you also the same thing. For 2 moments, imagine that you're a police officer. And after completing a hard day at work, you're returning home. So when you're returning home, you're waiting at a bus stop. And then somebody starts shouting, stop that thief, stop that thief, stop that thief. And you see somebody running. Obviously, that person has run away with somebody's purse. So you start running behind it. And because he's ahead of you, you're behind, you know he's a thief. So you punch him, you catch up with him, you run fast, and you catch up and you punch him from behind. So this person, he lands on his face. So this person, who's just now run away with a purse, is running, you catch up with him and you punch him in his back, and he falls on his face. So you have not seen his face. You know he's a thief. You're beating him and punching him. You're a police officer. And after beating him and punching him for 5 minutes, you also want to see his face and you turn him around. And when you turn him around, you find out he's your younger brother. So I asked a question to this student. When you find out that he's your younger brother, will you still continue beating that person? You know he's stolen. You're a police officer. Will you do that? So what could the student do? The student said, yes, I will. Then I asked the second question. The kind of intensity with which you are beating that person till now, will your next punch, that thief who happens to be your other brother, will be of the same intensity as the previous punches when you did not see his face? So all of us know the answer, yes? That's what we are talking of here. My personal value is that I love my brother. Arjun is saying, Utsanna Kula Dharma. He says, I have some duties. He's my guru. He's my grandfather. I am supposed to offer flowers at their feet and you are asking me to shoot arrows towards them. But on the other hand, his Varna Dharma, his Kshatriya duty is to protect those who are innocent and to kill or harm those who are atrocious. So we are discussing here a conflict in everyone's heart. My personal values and the social ethics. Now, if this is a conflict that is there in all of us, my question to you is, why is this conflict being faced? If right is right, it should be right for him, it should be right for him, it should be right for him, and it should be right for everyone. If something is wrong, it should be wrong for everyone. But why is there a conflict in everyone's heart when it comes to application? So modern world especially has made it very complicated. Previously things were very clear. Now the problem is we have changed our definitions. So I showed you some definitions in the first slide. There was a definition of ethics, there was a definition of values. I'll show you some definitions. What is the definition of viral? Some years back, the definition of viral was, you know, disease spreads. Whatever is the definition of viral? Yes? So something that was very harmful is now considered very good. Are you viral? So now if you ask this to an 80-year-old person, he says, no, I'm not viral. Then a youngster says, yes, I'm viral. Yes? What is sharing? Is sharing good? Obviously it's good. Sometime back, sharing was sharing a piece of cake. Today sharing is about how much time you spend because of course. So agar kisi boodhe vyakti ko puchenge, sharing acha hai ki nahi? Dadaji, bole bahut share karna chahiye. And then if you talk that dadaji, you come with a cell phone and there are four friends sitting with you and you're passing YouTube videos and whatnot. And he says, beta kitna samay barbaad karte hain aap. So definition of sharing has changed. What is an apple? An apple a day keeps the doctor away. It's a healthy, yes? Now today when somebody has an Apple phone, you know, you tell him don't spend so much time on the cell phone, yes? So we have changed our definitions. What's a berry? Well, this berry is very healthy. These berries are not healthy. So what I'm saying is, with the advancement of technology, we have changed our definitions. And that is where the conflict in our life was. So my question to you is, in this picture, what is important? Can you see these three pieces here? Yes? Now I'll show you something else. Can you see something else? So our problem is, in our lives, previously we had people who were important. And now we have things that are important. So because we shifted the focus, the problem is, we should use things and love people. But now today, we love things and use people. Is it true?
Yes.
Yes. Is it realistic?
Yes.
So this is where the root of the conflict between ethics, values and today's teenagers, because we are talking of education. We are talking of how to transmit these values to our teenagers. So I have a video here and I'll request our team to play this video.
Thank you.
So, you know, my friend who spoke the previous topic, he was talking about technical education. What happens when you're working on a computer and sometimes that computer crashes? The programming was not done by a competent engineer. You get irritated. But what do you lose? Your peace of mind, maybe some money, yes? 5 years back, I used to go to a temple. And outside the temple, there was a board which was kept. It said, cell phones not allowed. So I said, okay. The next year when I went to the temple, it was mentioned, cell phones allowed, but keep them on vibrating mode. What to do? The world has changed. The next year, he says, I went to the temple, they said, deposit your cell phone here, and then you can take darshan. He says, now when I go to the temple, they said, for a selfie with Bappa, deposit 500 rupees here. So similarly, I've talked to students joining medical colleges in their first year, and I asked them, what is your reason for coming to a medical college? And they said, pure humanity. Some of them will tell me, I want to eradicate diseases from this world. Very high talk. By second year, they say, actually, it's one of the most respected professions. That's why I want to become a doctor. So it has changed. By third year, they say, sir, you know what, actually, there's a lot of money that comes in this medical profession. By final year, or internship, they say, sir, cut practice. Anybody here knows what is cut practice? I'm a doctor, and when some patient comes to me, for no good reason, I ask him to get an MRI scan. I ask him to go for an X-ray. I ask him to go for a CT scan. And the CT scan fee is 5,000 rupees. So out of this 5,000 rupees, 2,000 rupees comes back to me. That is called cut. And it is called cut practice. And 95% of doctors around the world, if not in India, in India, it's quite rampant, engage in this cut practice. So next time you go to a doctor and you get advice for some, you know, some report like this, check with another doctor. So why am I telling you this? I talked to you about the changing aspirations of a doctor as he goes through first day, second. So by the time I meet them, after they have passed their MBBS, I ask them, do you still remember what you answered to me in your first year? Why did you join medicine? Everything has changed. It's all about money, money and more money. Most of the students who pass out to medical, they also go for postgraduate education. And I ask them, out of all these branches, radiology, orthopedics, pediatrics, general medicine, general surgery, which one will you choose? They say, which one will give you the most amount of money? If you check out now in the outside world, the highest sought after postgraduate branch is radiology. You know why radiology? Because there's no risk. You don't perform a surgery on anything. You just look at reports. It's a very pleasurable job. Sit on a chair, watch reports like this and give your diagnosis and you get the highest amount of money. It has nothing to do with saving lives. At one point of time, medical education was supposed to be noble profession. If somebody is a doctor, you would say he's into noble profession. It's no longer noble now. And that's why there's a very urgent need to understand how to integrate ethics and values in medical education. We'll go ahead. Let me go to the next slide. For some reason, this computer gets So there are some diseases of the body which we would like to talk about. Cancer is one very deadly disease. AIDS is one very deadly disease. But do you know, 61% of cancer patients have forgiveness issues. So in the previous video that you saw, did you see this teacher at the end of the video? He had a look on his face. How do I forgive myself and how do I talk to my daughter now that I am responsible for her mother dying? Now, do you, for a moment, don't raise your hands, just ask this honest question to yourself. In your life, is there somebody who has messed up your life? At least you think so, for no good reason. And you think, I can forgive anyone and everyone in this world, but not this person. If the answer is yes, you are 61% prone to having a cancer. So my humble question to all of you is it good if somebody comes and teaches you the quality of forgiveness? In addition to all the different things that you're learning in life, in this institute and that institute, what if somebody teaches you how to be a friendly, cooperative person? Is it good? Will it help to reduce the statistic? So I want to talk about not bodily cancers, I want to talk about four emotional cancers. Is it okay to talk about four emotional cancers? How many of you want to know about the four emotional cancers? Yes. Okay. So the four emotional cancers, cancer starts from C. So we have the C. First, we start comparing the people. Why is he like this? Why is she like this? Then, if comparison is something which is passive, then we turn to the active principle of competing with that person. This person cannot be better than me. And this is all pervading, everyone is subject to this. If competition does not work, if I am not able to excel this person, then I can do one thing, pull him down. So how do? I complain about that person to some superior. आपको पता है कि एक व्यक्ति क्या करता है? लंच ब्रेक में ऐसा करता है, वैसा करता है. Some, if I cannot rise myself higher, I have to pull him down. And if that does not work, I come into criticism. I start spreading rumors. What is Facebook full of? They say half of Facebook is just full of rumor mongering and criticizing. What is this person and what is that person? Very less positive things going on Facebook. Yes. Now I'll give you the solutions for this. The medicine is, instead of comparing somebody, try to be content with what you have. In management terms, there is something called as a SWOT analysis. Anybody here knows what is a SWOT analysis? Strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Anytime you become sad in life, think about what are your strengths and also what are your weaknesses. You'll be amazed to find somebody sitting next to me has some strengths, and I always focus on that person's strengths and my weaknesses. But the Supreme Lord is so kind, all of us sitting here have our own strengths. So think about your strengths and you'll find out somebody sitting next to you has a weakness in that. It's not that all of us are losers. We have some opportunities and we have some threats also, but your opportunities are your personal property. The opportunities in your life are not in anybody else's life. Try to focus on your opportunities, try to focus on your strengths. So that is, try to be content with what you have already received instead of looking at another person's plate. Can I give you a small scenario just to get deeper into this? Is it okay? Imagine you go to a lunch, somebody's function, somebody's marriage or something, and there's a nice lunch there, and you'll check at the menu there. There are 20 items lined up. You say, wow, this is my lucky day, 20 items per piece. You take a plate, and when you look at the plate, you put different bowls there. Now when you count the bowls are only 10. You know what it means? It means out of those 20 items, you can only take 10. Just in case, you know, you are not somebody who carries two plates. So now you think, out of these 20 items, I can only choose 10. Which ones will you choose? Which ones will you like the most, is it not? So after thinking, So in this way, you choose the 10 most favorite items that you like, and you sit, and you are relishing. If you like gulab jamun, you say, wow, gulab jamun. The rasgulla is also there, but there's not sufficient space in my plate. And then somebody comes with another plate. And he's also facing the same problem. So he also has 10 bowls in his plate. But his 10 bowls are different from your 10 bowls. You took a gulab jamun, you took a rasgulla, you took bhindi sabji, he took paneer sabji. But when you took that bhindi sabji, you had a choice. Don't answer this question, you don't have to raise your hand. Is it okay if I say, even after you choosing all your favorite items, when you start eating and you look at others' plate, you see? That's what I mean. So we have to learn to be content with the choices that we made. Okay, the next one is, instead of competing with people, learn to collaborate with people, learn to cooperate with people. My strengths, his weaknesses, when we come together, it becomes our strengths. And if he has a strength, I have a weakness, when we come together, it is our strength again. Then instead of complaining, contribute. We might fix in each other. So he's puzzling. This working. This project is not working properly. So he says, you know, I have what I have, what can I do? If I really want to contribute, what I can do is, you know, teach him how to keep the microphone properly, or teach him some tricks with the projector and it does properly. We end up complaining about so many things. We should have to contact him, is it not? And then instead of criticizing, let us go to somebody and compliment that person. You know what? You're such a nice audience. Please give yourself a clap. Since you're sitting here and learning all these difficult difficult topics. We need to compliment people. Yes? So these are for emotional cancers that happen when we have forgiveness issues. And when we have forgiveness issues, when we have ethical issues, as we saw in that video. So this is somebody very famous. Anybody knows who is this? This is the first humanoid robot called Sophia. She recently visited IIT Bombay. She's completely machines. And they asked her different questions like, what is the population of India? Who's the Prime Minister of Fiji? And all those different questions. I'll ask you one question. If this Sophia is asked a question like, there's somebody who came into your room, she's sleeping, and somebody came into the room and is stealing something, and she wakes up, and she catches that person, and that person says, chhod do, chhod do. So she says, kyun chhod do? Aapko to jail mein dalna chahiye. He says, for the last 10 days, with my family, people are starving. Actually, I'm a nice person, but seeing the sad faces of my children, seeing the sad faces of my wife, I'm forced to steal. And look what I have stolen. It is only 100 rupees. Look in your locker, in the cupboard, there was 10,000 rupees. I did not steal 10,000 rupees. I just stole 100 rupees just to feed my children. Will she be able to take a decision to leave the thief?
No.
Will you take a decision to leave the thief?
Yes.
Yes?
Yes.
That is what is the difference between an ethical person and a non-ethical person. Most of us, because of an overexposure to technology, although we are living, but we have been programmed to think in yes or no. Yes, that's how much time more? 2 minutes, okay. So our problem is, because we are spending too much time with gadgets, we are also getting into right or wrong. A medical entrance test, you know what is MCQ? Multiple choice questions. It's all filled with MCQs. So somebody who's gotten into medicine by writing an MCQ, who passes out of medicine by writing an MCQ, what do you think happens to him when he faces ethical questions on the operation theater? He cannot take a decision. So we have to learn to change. So we have two duties. We have to balance our heart with our brain. Too much head thinking, and then we become hard-hearted. And too much hard thinking, we become very emotional. Krishna in the Gita says, Aham sarvasya prabhavo, mattam sarvam pravartate, iti matva bhajate ma, buddha bhava samanvita. So he uses two words, buddha bhava. Buddha means buddhi, and bhava means man. So Krishna says, if you really want to worship me, don't just use your heart, use your brain also. And don't just use your brain, use your mind also. So our problem today is we tend to go to extremes. Today's situation is faster technology, 4G, but slower discrimination. Today's problem is easier access to gadgets, but lesser monitoring. Both parents are working in office. Today's problem is there is faster cultural degradation, but there is lesser conscience inside. And that is why ethical education is very important. This person here is throwing a television. Maybe he got frustrated here. What is something that will happen 2 seconds after this? Can anyone tell you? You know, so you see that rope there? There's a rope that is tied here. So in trying to invite commodities into our life, we have given up communities. In trying to give up information from our life, actually we have created propaganda. So have we given up certain good things from our life in order to get some good things from our modern perspective? Yes? We had joint families. Now we gave up the joint families and now we are going for nuclear families. So when you give up nuclear families, when you give up joint families, you don't have anybody to talk to. Pehle chacha, chachi, mausa, mausi, dada, dada, nani, nani, sab the na saath mein. Kahin na kahin mata pita se sab baat nahi kar sakte. Dadi ji se bhi kuch baatein kar sakte the, abhi kuch nahi kar sakte. To fir kya karenge? Mr. Google pe dhoondte. And Mr. Google does not have any ethics. He does not know what results to show to a tiny kid. He sees something on that screen which is not supposed to see. And then parents are thinking, bachpan mein chote bachche hai na, sometimes there is some family, they say, sir, ye hamara beta hai na, first standard mein hai, isko sab aata hai, Google aata hai, YouTube aata hai, and what not. And 5 years later when I visit them, they say, sir, isko kuch bolo na, with his point, he has access to some information that he should not have access to. That's it. A teacher's responsibility is, just like this person here is molding that clay. Similarly, a teacher who's part of the education process, actually he can shape a person's destiny. He can slowly make that person a happy person. But for that, the teachers themselves have to be pure. The teachers themselves have to be educated in it. So my personal story is, when I was in school, one time I saw a poor student copying. And I went to my father and I asked him, how can he cheat? I didn't have the courage to report to the teacher. So my father said, let him do it. One thing you remember, you don't cheat in your exams. So this happened in my 6th standard. And because this happened in my 6th standard, I was saved from so many times this temptation came to me also to cheat. Yes, I had a father who taught me. In my college days, I saw some students whose parents lived, whose parents had big hospitals. And I used to see them wasting time in the college. And I used to ask one of my senior friends, I asked, how come they just waste their time in the college? They don't study here. And he said, actually, unke pitaji ka pehle se hi hospital hai. We are here just to pass out. Pass out, okay, aur usse bhi jaake waiting hai hospital chalayenge, 1737% profit kamayenge. They are interested in study. And I used to think, is this right? Somebody who has a facility but does not have any interest to study, whereas there are people who have such a deep desire to study but they don't have the facilities. Have you ever faced such ethical questions? When I joined as a teacher, one time, one student was arguing with me and he asked me a question. Sir, ek baar na, main hospital mein tha, aur hospital mein kuch police, they brought a gangster. This gangster had committed more than 100 murders. And one day the police shot him. And with a deep wound here, he came to the OT and I was supposed to operate on him. So he asked me this question since he saw me as a teacher of the Gita. He said, sir, kya karna chahiye? क्योंकि मुझे मालूम है मैं इस गैंगस्टर को ठीक करूंगा ये बाहर जाके और 100 मर्डर करेगा एंड इफ आई जस्ट प्रिटेंड टू डू समथिंग एंड आई डोंट एक्चुअली क्योर हिम ही डाइज एंड इन दैट सेंस आई एम सेविंग सो मेनी लाइव्स व्हाट शुड आई डू इफ समबडी आस्क्स यू दिस क्वेश्चन व्हाट विल योर आंसर बी वुड समबडी लाइक टू आंसर दिस क्वेश्चन शुड ही सेव दैट गैंगस्टर और शुड ही किल दैट गैंगस्टर नोइंगली सेव व्हाई शुड ही सेव सो दैट्स द आंसर दैट वी आल्सो गेव It was a tough time to convince him that he said, sir, aisa kaise bol sakte hai aap? Gangster ko to maarna chahiye na. I said, no, gangster ko maarna police ki duty hai. Doctor ki nahi hai. He's been brought there for to be saved by you. So these are some ethical questions that haunt the lives of an engineer, but more so of a doctor. We just finished one of the slides. So this is a jar of honey here. And this is a child who's licking. And there is something that is missing in between. You see this, this is one picture, this is one picture. There is something special. What is the missing intermediate step? Somebody has to open the lid. It looks very inviting and then only you can taste it, is it not? So all of us need somebody in our life who can teach us how to open the lid. Then only we can taste the sweetness. Most of us are looking at a jar of honey and thinking, wow, it looks so tasty, it looks so interesting. When can I taste it? And that is why you need honest, pure people in your lives. There has to be at least one honest, pure personality in your life who actually lives by the ethics. And just looking at him, you feel, I also live by those principles. This was one video, but we don't have time. I'll go to the last slide of this presentation. This is the... This is a wallet experiment. This was an experiment done by Reader's Digest. Anybody knows here? Reader's Digest is a very famous magazine. They dropped 168 wallets and they had equivalent to something like $200 in different cities of the world. So this includes cities like New York, Germany, Netherlands, Prague, Ljubljana, Bombay, Bucharest, Budapest, Warsaw, Moscow also. And there are these three different colors here, green, orange and red. So red is where they just dropped 12 wallets anywhere in the city and 0 to 4 wallets were returned. They also put the address there. Orange is where 5 to 8 wallets per return and green is where 9 to 12 wallets per return. Now, my honest question to you is New York a rich city? Is everyone wants to go there, is it not? Is Moscow a rich city? Is India a poor country? That's what we are made to believe, is it not? Now, the interesting thing is, in this so many cities here, only Helsinki and Bombay 9 out of 12 wallets per return. ये पैसा हमारा नहीं है, किसी का गिरा है, देखते हैं किसी का, अच्छा, इनको वापस कर दिया है। And let's check what is the report of London. London is 5 wallets per return. New York is red. New York is 8 wallets returned, and Lisbon, Prague is 2 wallets. Madrid, Spain is 2 wallets returned. What does it mean? I just want to ask you this question. How come seemingly poor countries returned most of the wallets, and seemingly rich countries, they kept those wallets? Can we draw some inference from it? Those countries who had spiritual values, what is spiritual value? Spiritual value is a policeman inside. जो चोरी करने की इच्छा होती है ना अंदर से आवाज आती है चोरी मत करो ये गलत है और जिसके पास वो वैल्यूज नहीं है जिसके पास वो एथिक्स नहीं है इट डजंट मैटर हाउ मच मनी यू हैव इन द बैंक अकाउंट व्हाट मैटर्स इज हाउ मच मनी कैन यू स्टील राइट नाउ सो दैट्स व्हाई यू हैव स्कैम्स ऑफ 5000 करोड़ हाउ मेनी जीरोस आर देयर इन 5000 करोड़ नन ऑफ अस नो वी डोंट सी ऑल दैट मनी बट हियर आर पीपल हु आर स्टीलिंग 5000 करोड़ एंड यू आस्क द क्वेश्चन व्हाट आर यू गोइंग टू डू विद 5000 करोड़ Nobody has an answer. So this is corruption. That is why medical education, technical education, all has to be very much supplemented with spiritual values. Our suggestions, quick suggestions, create a strong cultural foundation. This is very important. Just these talks won't work. Talks inspire you for 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Again, the rest of the culture, it falls on you. So we have to have youth festivals for edutainment, which is the marriage of education and entertainment. All kids love fun, all kids love games, but then there has to be some education mixed with it. Contests and youth gatherings do not allow your values to conflict with the social values. So with these few words, we'll stop here. And there are some programs that we do for medical students. You can see here, there are students who are interested in learning the Gita. There's a Janmashtami program where so many students are interested. Thank you very much. If you want more information, you can visit us on Thank you for going a little bit. There are some computer snacks, so please forgive us.
Any question from audience? Thank you, sir, for discussing ethic, value, truthfulness, simplicity, humanity, and today's medical hospital issue regarding kidney rackets and catheter reuse. Again, give the knowledge about the social ethics and personal value, how to differentiate. Thank you for saying truly knowledge people cannot difference between the people. Again, change the definition today's viral sharing apple and berry. And one interesting quote, use the things and love the people, but today's era, use the people and love the things. Changing the definition of cancer, 4 important cancer and its medicine. And showing the 2 duties of teacher and again suggesting the Gurukul type of education. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. Now I request the chairperson to felicitate Sri Nandanandan Das.
Our next speaker is BK to please come on stage and I request our chairperson to please introduce our speaker to the audience.
Welcome, Hinayamjiya. B.K. Ritu ma'am completed her MBA with specialization in HR Institute for ITM Management. Certified happiness practitioner by University of California and internationally certified professional behavior analyst. She is awarded World HRDA Congress Award or awarded her in Asian HR Leadership Award in 2017 for outstanding contribution in training and development. The award had participation for various countries in Asia and the event was held at Dubai. Reliance Communication awarded her with Outstanding Performance of the Year for her contribution in the training and development. B.K. Ritu has an insightful experience of more than a decade in the training and development where she has conducted training program at various corporate, army, force, educational institute and hospital also. She is associated with Brahma Kumaris for past 12 years. She contributed the training at Mumbai and Navi Mumbai. She has addressed more than 800 participants in 3 conferences organized for various armed force organizations, Army, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, Parliamentary, State Police, etc. and conducted the session for the student as well as faculty at various educational institutes. So I request
Vijay
to Madam, please start now.
Time listening to the entire interaction, beautiful interaction that's going on. I really enjoyed the previous session absolutely thoroughly, and I was totally engrossed into the discussion. Just one request, can I request all of you to just stand up for a minute? Is that okay? Would you be comfortable? Great. So what we will now do is, I want you to raise your hand, okay? And I want you to move your hand in clockwise direction. So what is clockwise? You go from 12 to, you go from 1, 2, 3, you go to 6, then you go to 9, and then you come back to 12 again. Okay, so your hand up, okay? You can draw a clock on the wall, if that's comfortable. So you can just look at the wall, and you can draw a clock on the wall. So you see a 12 very carefully with all your attention there on the wall. With your finger you draw that clock on the wall which goes from 12 to 3 to 6 to 9 to 12 again. Keep doing that for a couple of seconds more. Interesting. Very nice. Great. Okay. So we are sure which way is the clockwise direction. Okay, so now what I want you to do is just keep your hand that way. Suppose my hand is here and I am drawing that clock on the wall. I continue to draw the clock clock on the wall in the clockwise direction, and slowly in the same way get your hand a little down. Slowly get your hand a little down, yeah. Continue to do that. Interesting. Okay. Just continue to do that. Just continue to move your hand in that same way, circle. Get your hand a little lower to your belly, level of your belly. And let the circle keep going. Very nice. Interesting. Okay. Just look at the direction of the circle. Is it clockwise going from 12, 3, 6, 9? Is it going clockwise? It's not? Oh, the instructions were so clear, it has to move clockwise. How did it change? What happened in between? Let's try once again. We'll try once again. Okay, so instructions very, very clear. What we're supposed to do is our hand up, in upward direction. We'll move our hand in clockwise direction from 12 to 3 to 6 to 9 to 12 again. And slowly the hand comes down in the same direction, moving in the clockwise direction. Very nice. Get your hand a little lower and yes, to your belly level. Keep moving, keep drawing the circle. So we have to do this. No problem. So which direction is it going, clockwise or anti-clockwise?
Anti-clockwise.
When you get your hand down here, is it going from 12 to 3 to 6 to 9? Yes, no, maybe? No?
Yes.
Okay, then how does it look now? It's going opposite direction. How does it go in opposite direction? Why is it going in opposite direction? The angle changes. Amazing. Angle of what changes? Vision changes. Okay, vision. How does the vision change? Thinking. Oh, did the thinking change? Did the thinking change? Not really, right? The hand is still moving. The hand kept moving in some direction. It's still moving. What changed?
Mind
changed. Okay, the hand is still moving. Perspective changed. How did the perspective change? Amazing, beautiful. Very nice answers coming in. I was looking at something from one direction. Now the direction changes and the way I look at things differ a little. Thank you so much. Wonderful. Please have a seat. Right, so last 2 days what we've been only trying to do is looking at things in a little different perspective. Wahi cheez hai jo hum ab tak karte aaye hain, kuch bhi nahi badalna hai, kuch bhi nahi chhodna hai. The only thing that changes is perspective or the direction in which we are looking at things, and maybe looking at things in a more value-based perspective. Okay? While we were driving down to this college, we realized that the car broke down. Okay, and the driver said, "Madam, sorry, we can't take you ahead of this." I said, "Oh my God, I have to reach, right? There's a conference and there's a session and I have to reach on time." And I said, "You know, come what may." So we waited at the highway, and at the highway, we were waiting for some cab. Since, you know, it's rainy season, there were no cabs available. We started walking. And because I wanted to be a little ahead of time, I wanted to be sure that I'm here before time, and so that I could, you know, just be with all of you for a little more while than just that half an hour, we started walking a little faster. Okay, in between I also ran. And I just, you know, the speed was increasing, and somehow we managed to reach the college before time. By the time we reached, how would I feel? Yes? Okay, happy. What would I need physically? Rest. Amazing. One is rest. What else? Water. Amazing. So something to drink, right? So as soon as I reach, I said, "Sir, I need something to drink because, you know, we've been walking for a long time and I'm really, really thirsty and I need something to drink." As soon as we reached and we asked for something to drink, we got two bottles. One, a bottle of water, and one, a nice cold drink. What would you think I would choose?
Water.
Water, sure. No, but he said, "No, ma'am, this is really good. You know, this is a regular water. This is like really good. It tastes good. You know, if you open it, there's a lot of soda, and you know, you'll feel really nice about it. You'll feel energetic before you go for the session." What would I still prefer?
Water.
Why would I prefer water? Any reason? Why would I prefer water?
At that time, body needs water.
At that time, body needs water. Beautiful. So, you know, our body is made up of these five elements. One of the most important elements, the body is made up of 70% water. When the level of water goes down, my body needs water. In place of water, you give me a nice cold drink, I would still prefer water. Today, are we seeking values in our relations? Are we seeking others to be honest with us? Are we seeking people to be compassionate towards us? Yes, no, maybe. तुमने ऐसा बोला ना इसीलिए whatever, you know. We are seeking these values from everywhere outside, from our college, from our societies, from our relations, our people. So we are seeking. Why are we seeking? As soon as I reach, I seek for water. Why? Because the level of water has gone down and my body needs water. Today we preached, you know, we walked so much in our journey of this human being in our journey, right? So humus is basically human word, it comes from humus, which means soil. Mitti, kehte na mitti, mitti mein ant mein mil jati hai. So ye soil, right? And being is that the energy which experiences these values. And today, why am I seeking these values from outside? Is because these values, the level of these values, at somewhere has depleted a bit in us. Right? So what do we do? What can be done now? So, you know, there's this beautiful thing which I heard where they said, you know, there is a village and everybody wanted a pond of milk there. And they decided what we'll do is we'll put a glass of milk. All of us will come together and put a glass of milk. Okay, easy. Each one contributes a little and that's how the pond is full of the pond is full of milk, right? Easy thing to do. What happened is one individual, he thought, let me not put a glass of milk, let me put a glass of water instead. Just one glass, how does it make a difference? So many people putting a glass of milk, how would people know what am I putting? Nobody comes to know any which ways, right? So what I did as an individual, I decided let me put a glass of water. Okay, slowly as the pond was getting full, people realized that it's more of water than why? I thought only if I put one glass of water, how would it make a difference? It's the difference that each one of us is making. A child at home, okay, is taught at home saying that honesty is the best policy. All of us have heard in our childhood, right? And let's say if somebody comes and, you know, the parents don't want to meet or they want to meet them later on, they say, "Wo to papa karte nahi hai." Honesty is the best policy. Suna tha, I heard about it, right? But are we able to see that anywhere around? It's just one glass of water, right? These little things, and then we are seeking these values outside. Why? Because here, these values have. And why are we seeking? Let's say, you know, on my first day of my job, I joined a company and they asked me to fill multiple documents. They said, you fill this document, you fill that document, and I started filling all of these documents. As I filled documents, I got really tired. You know, the first day is really, half a day goes in just filling up documents. Then the HR of the organization, human resource department, they said, ma'am, there is one more document that you need to fill. I said, oh my God, one more document. Said, that is your salary account document. I said, yeah, that's important. Okay, so I was happy about it. I said, no problem, you get that person, I'll fill the document. I have no issues with filling the document. And the person got that document, and I very lovingly filled that document, and I said, okay, and I started thinking how, you know, in the month, in the end of the month, there's a message which comes. What does it say? Your account has been credited with so and so amount, right? And I feel very happy about it. Okay, as the month goes by, what happens? The account gets debited a little. Towards the end of month, what happens? I become very cautious of my expenses. I become a little worried. If there's something which comes up, I have to be very, very, you know, cautious about it. And then I keep waiting for the next one to come. Agla kab aayega? The next salary, when will that get debited? So I'm waiting. Similarly, each one of us on our this journey of human being, right? This body and the soul. This journey of human being, we also have this beautiful account which is called values account. How does it get credited? When does it get credited, this account? Amazing. When I do anything which is, you know, compassionate, I don't seek respect, but I start giving respect, right? I don't ask for person to be honest, but I express the value of honesty. So today, that, okay, one is that society becomes like that, but today can I put that one glass of milk myself, take that responsibility and become a role model, not for the world, but at least for my child at home, at least for my students around. Right? How does it help? Okay, it helps the world or the other person, but it definitely increases the credit in my value or my emotional bank account. Right? Today, if you are feeling a little, you know, if there is a little debit, what happens in a, you know, in that account, if there is a debit, we feel a little, be careful, we feel a little stressed because we can't spend so much and so many other things. But here, when our values get debited, and we don't have to do much. A little of opposite of compassion and this gets debited. How do we feel? How do you feel when you are really angry at a person and you bash a person right, left and center? How do you feel? You may have done it for the right reason. Let's say I'm a boss, my team doesn't perform and I feel really upset about it because we've not met our targets and I'm really, really sad about it. And I go to my team and I bash them right, left and center saying that why haven't you guys performed? Because of you. This is the, you know, impact that it has on the business, on the organization, and on the team. I go and tell them all of this. Or in our case, you know, the students don't perform well, or the project is not submitted, the research doesn't get, you know, accomplished. So how do you feel? Even when you, for the right reason, you have shouted at someone, or, you know, said something, how do we feel? Do we feel, kitna achha laga? इतनी अच्छी फीलिंग आ रही है पूछो नहीं has anybody said that nobody would ever say nobody of us would ever feel comfortable or at ease when we express anything which is opposite of these values we still do it and why somewhere can I sit with myself today, tell myself that let me start expressing these values, not because, you know, I want others to be, but I want to experience a lot of peace in life, I want to experience a lot of happiness in life, I want to experience that value of honesty which gives me a lot of pride and, you know, that feeling of comfort. What is this ease? Very beautifully put, you know, by the previous speaker, brother was saying that cancer and the medicine of it, you know, so criticism leads to cancer, complimenting leads to healing, right? So this ease is nothing but when I am not at ease, then I am expressing opposite of these values, right? So today, let me start crediting, let me take that ownership of putting that glass of milk in the pond. When I start doing, there are chances that people around me, I'm not saying they're not doing, absolutely they're doing, but in our daily routine life, somewhere, you know, this anger or maybe a little dishonesty which we justify saying, mera hi to ek glass hai, right? So a little glass of, all of these little things are somewhere, you know, having that impact of that pond becoming half full of maybe milk and half full of water maybe, which is not our objective. We don't want our next generations to have half water and half milk. We want them to have healthy milk, right? So today, let us sit with ourselves and check for ourselves. Is there anything that I can contribute to make this pond full of milk? Or at least increase the content of milk, the level of milk in this pond? That's my ownership and that's my responsibility and that's why all of us are here today. And meditation is a beautiful technique, right? Meditation is a technique through which we program our mind, our subconscious mind for these values, for expressing these values. Like you said, you know, we don't want to be angry or we don't want to express anger to somebody because it doesn't make us feel comfortable. In a similar way, if we are doing the opposite of peace, which is anger, the reason is somewhere the level of peace has gone down. So in meditation, what we do is we experience more of the values that we actually want to experience in our lives, and that's what programs our subconscious mind for the values which we want to experience in our life. So can we take a couple of minutes to do that? Would you like to do that? Yes? Great. Very, very relaxed, very comfortable. Your back straight, because as your back is straight, your mind becomes relaxed. Your feet resting on the ground. Let the chair take your weight. For your own self, away from your roles, your responsibilities, your work, a little time for your own self. Just feel if there is any tightness in the body, any heaviness is slowly dissolving. And the body is very, very relaxed and light. Your legs, stomach, lungs, heart, hands, fingers, face, facial muscles, your brain, getting completely relaxed and light. Slowly observe your mind. What is it that you're thinking right now? Don't stop your thoughts, just slowly observe them. Once you observe your mind becomes relaxed. Thoughts are slowly fading away. Now slowly observe. Experience the gap in between these thoughts. Just be with the gap which is there in between these thoughts. Very, very relaxed, very comfortable. And I tell myself, I am a peaceful being. Just experience peace that comes along with this thought. Now I tell myself, I am a happy being. I'm a compassionate person. These are my natural values. I'm a strong and courageous person. Come what may, I have the strength to carry on. I experience these values completely and fully. Be with these thoughts, be with the feeling, very, very relaxed, at peace with yourself. Just be with your breath. In
your own time, you can open your eyes, you can move your fingers and keep the little bit very, very relaxed. Continue step by step. The day to program our subconscious mind. Subconscious mind is basically, from place where all our reactions come. The situation I, the way I react, it comes from my subconscious, the feeling that follows. Whatever I think, oh, it's already 1:30, I'm hungry to go for lunch. Thought, which makes me dis-ease, a thought that it's okay, it's a beautiful experience. The feeling is positive. So thought, which is followed by feeling, and the image that I give to myself. So I just said that I'm a peaceful being. I experienced it and I saw myself in a very, very peaceful manner right now. And this is how our subconscious mind gets programmed, right? And that's where the behavior then starts changing. Whatever, however you program your computer, it will give you same output, right? Similarly, the way we program our subconscious mind, it gives same kind of output. And you are most welcome and you are invited to learn Raja Yoga meditation, which is taught by
Because
everything has happened.
Lunch also.
Lunch also.